DNA nanostructures. So I will start by just introducing the Ned Seaman, that was the pioneer of the DNA nanotechnology. And he has made, in the last 30 years, a large number of structures that now are very common in a lot of laboratories. Then I would like also to introduce Paul Rothman and the DNA origami technique. That is is one of these DNA nanostructures. And what is important is that it uses a single-stranded phage DNA that has 7,000 bases, and that's called the M13 DNA. And then by using around 200, 300 staples, it can fold the DNA structure to make any match. So you need to select 200 oligonucleotides to make different figures. For example, this is what he predicted based on DNA calculations and selection of DNA sequences. And this is what he really made. So it was a fantastic technique to make objects. These objects are limited by the size of the DNA, the M13 DNA, that is around close to 100 nanometers. Okay. So then we were totally amazed of all these improvements. And one of the things that we did in our laboratory a few years ago is just to use these origamis, the rectangular origamis, where we introduced aptamers that binds to a protein called thrombin. So then in these aptamers are G-rich, and we introduce a methyl guanine. This, why? Because there is a protein that is a human alkyl transferase that is able to remove this methyl group. And this reaction is difficult to follow. So what we said is a series of aptamers, one that are well done, in the right, in the left, aptamers that are modified with this methyl guanine, and then we can add the enzyme, and the modified thrombin becomes unmodified, and then you see the thrombin binding in the right, in the left. So in the absence of the enzyme, you only see thrombin in the right. But if we add this enzyme, you get thrombin in both sides. This is the reading. So it is a visual way to see a chemical reaction, that is the removal of this methyl group. Okay, so this is, for example, the unmodified, the methyl modified origamis. And then by adding an increased amount of this protein, you see that the occupancy of the left side of the origami becomes bigger. So this is, by just counting the number of thrombin molecules in the right and in the left, you can measure the activity of this enzyme. It is very important for cancers. Okay, so that's a second example that we did 5 years ago. This is to use the origami to functionalize surfaces. So in that, these origamis, what we wanted to do is to make images of gold nanoparticles in gold surfaces. So what we did, we select this origami and we add in a certain position a line of oligonucleotides that have tile groups. Then you can add that into a gold surface and you can denature the whole oligonucleotides. That all the DNA will live, but it will remain the DNA that is thiolated. This is because there is a chemical reaction between the thiol group and the surface. Then we can address these oligonucleotides by hybridization. If these oligonucleotides contain gold nanoparticles, what we have to obtain is a line of all nanoparticles. And that is what we get. If you see in this image, we get lines of gold nanoparticles on gold surfaces. That is, was one of the first times that, that this was achieved. But today I would like to talk, we'll go to another density is in another direction, that is the use of DNA nanostructures for drug delivery. Yeah? So there is a very important studies in to use different nanoparticles to deliver drugs in certain places. So usually these nanoparticles are gold nanoparticles or lipid nanoparticles or polymer nanoparticles. These are defined and homogeneous nanoparticles in what you put the drug by chemical means or by association, no? But you also can use DNA or origami. So now the whole nanoparticle is a DNA nanoparticle that is totally defined. So, and that is what I will talk. I have to say that in the field of the nanostructures, we have the origami that I was explaining to you that needs M13, and you can make objects of 100 nanometers. And then you have the other techniques that do not use M13 that could be, can provide different sizes. So from very small 10 nanometers to hundreds of nanometers. Okay, so this is one of the examples, for example, where you have a tetrahedron that carries a SAE RNA that has a folic acid. So this injected to the animals, you get the reduction of a tumor because the SAE RNA is selectively addressed to these tumors. This is another example, so it's a more recent one, and I would say it's one of the nicest examples, in where you have a DNA origami that you feel of a protein thrombin, and this it provokes coagulation of the blood. So in order to deliver that to the tumors, they close this origami in a cylindrical way. You see here the picture. And in this form, these origamis are not toxic, but it has an oligonucleotide that binds nucleolin that is only present in tumor. So when these cylinders arrive to the environment of the tumor cell, then it is open and empty this thrombin, provoking the coagulation of the blood vessels in the tumor. So this is is called a nanorobot, and is a fantastic example of the use of DNA nanotechnology for the precise delivery to the target molecules. Okay. So this is another example, also in mice, that is just an origami that uses doxorubicin, because doxorubicin is an intercalant. In this case, the drug is bound to the DNA structure just by intercalation. This also provides a very good reduction of tumor in mice. So, in general, I have to say that DNA structures have the advantages that are very well defined architectures. You can add exactly the number of drug molecules that you want, and you can add whatever you like to direct these compounds to the target tissue. As a disadvantage, usually are big molecules and are difficult to enter to the cells, and they are expensive. And in principle, you have to introduce in vivo targeting. Okay, so the second part of my talk will be about FdU. This is just a small oligonucleotides made of floxuridine are able to, if it gets into the cells, they can be hydrolyze and form the monophosphate of this nucleoside that has the active drug. So the talk will be about the use of DNA nanostructures to deliver these small antiproliferative oligomers. So this is the first molecule that we prepare. This is the tetrahedron. It is made of six oligonucleotides, and each one of these oligonucleotides carry either drugs or either molecules to facilitate cell uptake. As a facilitator, we have cholesterol, and as a drug, we have this deca nucleotide, so it's an oligonucleotide of 10 bases that carries 10 floxuridines. So then the working concentration are about 5 micromoles, and this is the second is a DNA origami. This is bigger, so this is, let's say, 10 nanometers, this is 100 nanometers, and now because it's so big, we can introduce much more oligonucleotides and much more cholesterol. So this is the molecules that we made, so increasing the number of the floxuridines and the number of cholesterol molecules. So for example, this one that has, these are 10 and 10 are 20 molecules of floxuridine. And in the origami, because we have much more positions, we can arrive to introduce 10s, so it means 60 molecules of floxuridine. And the number of cholesterol is also increasing. So this is the first thing, is that we have to demonstrate that all this chemistry, all these compounds that we made do not affect the cell assembly. And that is done, could be done by gel electrophoresis. You see a single band. Then you can go to the FAM and see that the origamis are well made. This has also electrophoresis. And this and the small tetrahedron, you can also visualize by FAM, but it's very difficult. This is right in the limit because it's only a few nanometers. Okay. So now the second Borio problem is that's the molecules that we do change the size of these structures, and the answer is no. Except in one case that had 4 cholesterols. In this case, we observe by DLS, if the size is usually is 20, 24 nanometers, we saw an increase. And this is usually due to aggregation, because we even could see 3 tetrahedrons in by electron microscopy. This is just cholesterol. So we cannot add too much cholesterol because it does provoke aggregation. So then in the origami, there's no problem at all because the origami is very big. So you can add everything that you like, and you see there's only a small increase from 124 to 140. So that is normal for the size of the molecules that we add. So the second thing is that we study the antiproliferative activity in cells. We select 2 cells that are fluorouracil resistant, and these are ones that are less resistant, and HCC that are very resistant to FdU. So we wanted to try to make a drug that is able to compensate this fluorouracil resistance. So these are cancer cells. So the first thing that we have to analyze is whether these origamis are able to enter, and we label with a fluorescein, and we see that inside of the cells we see the presence of the fluorescent derivative, so it does enter. So in the large origami, is a little bit more difficult to enter. But we saw, as you see here, this is done by cyber green labeling. You see cells that has inside the origamis, and when you add 4 cholesterols, then the cellular uptake is very big. So then we studied the antiproliferative activity of these compounds, and we saw that in the case of the tetrahedron, we have the best activity was this tetrahedron that has two cholesterols and one molecule. To observe that the adding 10 more, let's say two FdU decamers, it does not improve. So it's better to have a small number of oligonucleotides. Then in the more resistant, we saw a little bit of change, and is the one that has four cholesterols, the one that is the more active. But also we saw that the addition of more FDU does not improve the activity. The case of the origami, we saw a little bit less answer because we are working in a very smaller concentration, 10 nanomolar and not 5 micromolar. And we see that the best is the one that has four cholesterols and four, that is 40 FDU nucleosides. In the more resistant cells, you see that the activity is less, but we still see that the four cholesterol for all oligomers are the best. Okay, so then we study another thing, that is the apoptosis. And with the difference, the MTT only takes in account the dead cells. While here we can see the cells that are ready to die. So because they start to the process of apoptosis. And we see that the activity of the origamis are much better than the one with the tetrahedron. So as large as is this things, as better is the activity in provoking apoptosis in these cells that are resistant to FDU. And the third experiment is the tumoral cell growth assay, in where what we do is we treat the cells only 24 hours with the drug, and then we separate the cells and let them grow 8 days. That means that if the cells are not functioning very good, will not form colonies. So, and that we see that the activity here is much better because we see that the maybe 24 hours with the MTT, we didn't kill the cells, but most of the cells are affected already. Yeah? And this, remember that these are FDU resistant cells. So this is a very good result. And you see the tetrahedron is the one that gives better activity. And you see this, again, with only one oligomer and two cholesterol, that's the best conditions. While in the HCC, it is good to have more and more cholesterol. This is, they are telling us that the cellular uptake is a very important issue here. And in the cholesterol and in the origami, we see exactly the same. But now this colony assay is less sensitive because we use 20 times less amount of the drug. And you see, but still we see some reduction of the colony formation with the highest cholesterol and the highest oligomer. And in the HCC, the best is the one that has more drugs, so the one that have that means 60 fluoropyrimidine cells. So these are the conclusions. So DNA, I think I can convince you that DNA nanostructures functionalized with FDU are more cytotoxic than conventional drug. The cholesterol content is an important factor because it helps the cellular uptake. DNA nanostructures loaded with these molecules overcome the FDU resistance of these cells, and we believe that the DNA nanoparticles could be used as anti-cancer drugs. Together with fluoropyrimidines. And this is all. I would like to thank you for your attention.